So this is the point I left you. Here I said the power is this Lorentzian, and if we optimize with respect, let's say, to epsilon, we'll get this expression here. And here is just a plot of the power as a function. What happened? Two parameters, epsilon and the driving gammas. You see there's a global maximum here. And this type of plot is quite useful in this field. We plot here the efficiency with respect to Carnot and the power relative to its maximum. And you can say most engines or refrigerators have this type of graph that you can say this would be the point of maximum efficiency, which is here, and this would be the point of maximum power. And I can read it here, this would be the point of efficiency at maximum power, and this graph, it would be about half, if you look at it. Now, you can see you have this red line here, which starts, you could say this would be a Carnot efficiency at this point here, 1, but practically you can never reach this, for sure not in a continuous engine. Because there's always a heat leak or something like that that means that at very low power you get nothing. You have to, there's a minimum amount of power that you need to just to generate your engine. So that's why this graph closes upon itself at this point. So this is where you start your engine, you get more and more power. The efficiency first increases until it reaches a maximum efficiency, which is not. That's what I talked about, the daisy car, you're here, you're not here, you're not in Carnot. And then my Lamborghini is over here. And then when I try to drive too fast, you know what happens, that's a disaster, the power goes down. So, okay, now we'll go to a topic I will start to talk about now, which is refrigerators, and to connect, we connect to the third law of thermodynamics. We didn't talk about it yet. So this is Walter Nernst, which we associate the third law to him. And what's interesting, he changed his mind. It means that he knew he was after something right, but his definition kind of floated. So he has a few papers. Each paper has a slightly different description. Part of it is because when he started, he didn't have quantum mechanics as something. So his ideas evolved with quantum mechanics. But this is a summary of two types of interpretations. And one, this is due to Landsberg. Landsberg kind of summarized this as two kinds of theorems. One is called Nernst heat theorem. It says the entropy of any pure substance in thermodynamic equilibrium approaches zero as the temperature approaches zero. So, if we translate this to quantum mechanics, it says that at zero temperature, our state should have the zero entropy, which means it's a pure state. So if we cool something to zero temperature, we get a pure state. So this is one statement. And the other is sometimes called the unattainability principle. And it says it is impossible by any procedure, no matter how idealized, to reduce any assembly to absolute zero temperature in a finite number of operations. So again, we'll try to address this. Here is a statement about, you can say, zero entropy at absolute zero. And here's another dynamical statement that says we can't reach them. So we'll try to put some light on these concepts in talking about refrigerators. So Let's go back to, you could say, our tricycle, the device that we talked about before. And this is the entropy production. And we already see, here I'll draw it here, because this will be our basis for our understanding. So three baths. So I want to cool the cold bath, and I want to take this to zero, or approach zero. And I'm going to do that by my refrigerator. This is TH. TW. Here's my device. So I'm going to flow like that and pick up from here. So as we said, we take a quant from C, we take a quant from B, and we generate a quant. This is the term we want to offer to take our refrigerator to work on. From the point of view of currents, here is I wrote the entropy production. So we see we want this to be larger than zero. If TC goes to zero, we already see that this current here, JC, has to go also to zero. Otherwise, I violate the second law of thermodynamics. So we can say that in order not to violate the second law, this heat current, JC, has to scale with temperature as 1 plus alpha, where alpha is some positive constant. So this will cancel this term. So you can say the second law implies that alpha is bigger or zero or equal to zero. And to make it stronger, I reduce this inequality and I say that alpha, you can say that a third law says that alpha has to be bigger than zero, which means that if it's equal to zero, I can get some finite number here, which I can compensate by the other terms. You can say the third law is stronger, says I can compensate by these terms. This term should by itself go to zero, the pumping rate out of the cold bath when I approach the absolute zero, which is this statement here. So this would be our dynamical statement on the first Nernst heat theorem, that the current should scale like that. Now we can look at the unattainability principle and look at it like that. Here is my cold bath. This is this piece here. Now I want to cool it. So you can say I can write the rate of temperature decrease as a function of time. And I can write it as some differential equation that looks like that, some constant T to the power of some power over here. So what does the unattainability principle say? That if we want to cool something, it should take infinite amount of time. So if we cool in finite time, we violate this principle. So if we put this equation, we solve this differential equation. If this exponent is smaller than one, we violate the third law of thermodynamics. So this exponent can be equal to one, then we get exponential decay to zero temperature. But it can be larger than one, then the decay will be slower. So you can say we translated these statements into something that now we can check and use our models to see which exponent we can get here and what can be. So these two statements can be related if we take into consideration the heat capacity of our cold bath. So you can see the current is proportional to the heat capacity times the change in temperature. And If we know how the heat capacity scales with temperature, and in many cases we know that, so let's have another exponent. This is how the heat capacity scales when the temperature goes to zero. We get a relation between all these exponents. Now, another very important statement about the third law is what's written here. That if our system is cooled to the absolute zero, it's a pure state. So if it's a pure state, it can't be entangled with the rest of the world. So it's like that. So if you want a heuristic understanding how the third law works, I can wave my hands and I can try to do that. I want to cool here, this bath here. So how do I do that? In order to cool, I need some type of interaction with this bath. If I need some kind of interaction, I need this operator, X or Y, or something that's related to me and what I want to cool. So I need some interaction. This interaction will generate entanglement. So I need entanglement in order to cool. But when I get colder and colder, I eventually reach a situation when I have no entanglement. So when I have no entanglement, I have no tool to cool. So I have to start somewhere. So this is, you can say, hand-waving explanation how the third law emerges. Okay, so now we'll treat it with our quantum refrigerator, like we had before, and we'll look for these two exponents in our models. So this is not a derivation, it will just say, do our models fit the third law and how? Now, what I'm going to use is this construction here, which is due to Szilard and Einstein, which is called an absorption refrigerator. It's in a refrigerator that uses heat to cool. So we go from here, we called it before W, here it's D, we go in this direction. Here's the design. If you want to, you can go to Wikipedia, for example, and find the about Leo Szilard and his invention. So, just the anecdote, the way it came out, that Szilard had maybe lunch or dinner with Einstein, and they were discussing accidents in refrigerators that happened in the 30s in Germany. The refrigerators, at that time, the coolant was ammonia, and the ammonia would explode and people would become poisonous. So they said they'll do something good for the people. They knew, probably Szilard and Einstein knew a little bit about thermodynamics, so they wrote a patent. And 1926, they have a patent and about an absorption refrigerator. And then comes another story which was related. Einstein, okay, they had lunch together, friends, but Szilard was a young student in Berlin. So Einstein said, okay, this poor guy needs the money. I'll give all the rights of the patent to Szilard. But Einstein didn't know that Szilard's family was so rich that Szilard could give the rights of the patent to Einstein. But never mind, they both lost it because then Nazi Germany came and they didn't make money on this patent. I don't think so. So this is what I'm going to use. The same device we described before. Here's our interaction. We're familiar with this. I'm going to operate this as a refrigerator. The same thing. So our entropy generation isn't like that, and we have it. Okay, this is my semi-classical derivation that I talked about before, changing this by a C number, getting rid of, so this will be a power-driven refrigerator in this direction, and this is what I reverse the arrows. This is what we talked about before our coffee break. This is the engine, so I'm not going to talk about now. And here, I'm going to show you two different refrigerators. This case, I changed my power source. It's not, doesn't have temperature, but it's random noise. So I have a source of random noise. So I go to somebody and gives me just go outside, hear the noise of the city, you have a random noise. I want my refrigerator to be driven by random noise. So this is, for example, this noise. So I connect this lead to random noise, and the question is, does this refrigerator work? So here's my Hamiltonian. So I reduce this part here, and I'm going to put my random noise here, this F of T, here is my random noise. And this is my noise field, and it's driving this exchange of particles between the hot and cold bath. So this is what I put here as my driving force. So this is a refrigerator driven by just noise. And here is the equation of motion of this refrigerator. This we have already. We know that if I have random noise, this operator we already called X, the one we have here. Random noise that I'm going to use is Gaussian, delta correlated. And we already know from Lindblad that the master equation for random noise is just a double commutator with this operator X that I have here. And now my master equation for the refrigerator has the hot side, the cold side, the hot side, the cold side, and the noise part. The noise is what I said. The cold, in this case, it can be local. The hot can be local. And now I can solve this. This is even simpler. And a similar refrigerator, since this nonlinear interaction is difficult to solve, I can go to very high temperature limit. So this power, I can go, instead of having this random noise, I can go to very high temperature, which is also means that the entropy generation here goes to zero. So this is the master equation if I replace this by a very high temperature source. And when I take the temperature to infinity, I get a very similar master equation that's random noise before. I get double commutator with X and a double commutator with this Y operator that we had in this SU2 algebra. So I just add another kind of noise term to it, and I get the C. So there's a point here. When I go to infinite temperatures, the entropy generation on my power bath goes to zero. Random noise is also a zero entropy power. It's not coherent, but still at zero entropy. So it's a little bit kind of, first it was confusing to us to think that random noise is zero entropy, but it is. It's a source that gives you power with zero entropy. So here's another master equation, it's the same type. And this, again, give you to homework. Once you write it like that, you can solve for these operators O. If we want to know the power, the cooling power, we can solve these equations. And we get this. So this is the power that comes from the cold bath, or the current that comes from the cold bath. And it has always a very similar type of structure. We have this piece here, H bar omega C. What is this? This is quantum mechanics. This is our quant. We're taking one element, one particle from the cold bath, and this is the amount of energy we're taking per event, if you want to think about that. Here we have a driving term. Here we have the gain. It appears again. So the difference in population between the cold bath and the hot bath. So we're driving against the gain. And here we have some additional kinetic terms which comes from here, these parts here. So if we want to look at the efficiency, we again get the auto efficiency for that, which is less than the Carnot efficiency for this bath. Now, I summarized for you all the refrigerators that I show, and I want to kind of say that all these refrigerators are very similar. So this is the one, the driven refrigerator. the first one here. So you have here this gain, this modified gain, because I split my energy levels, but still it has this quant of energy, my coupling. So here's my the same Lorentzian that we saw before, times the gain. If I have a three-level absorption refrigerator, it also looks very similar. Here, delta, and these terms, and the gain. The gain looks a little bit different, but it's the same idea. A noise-driven refrigerator, again, you have the same structure. This H per omega C, these kinetic coupling terms, and here we have the driving, which just comes through noise, and the gain. And we also tried the Poisson noise instead of Gaussian noise. We get, at this level, the same expression. You can say there are differences here in Poisson. There's a modification for a frequency. But what I'm trying to explain here is that all these refrigerators, from a general point of view, look the same, these driven refrigerators. Now our exercise is to go to cold temperatures. TC goes to zero. So I can take the expressions that each one of them, doesn't matter which I take. I take this and take the limit when TC goes to zero, approaches zero, and distill out of that the relevant expressions that when I try to reach the absolute zero. So I get something that looks like that. The current that I get out of my cold bath, this one here, quant of energy, kinetic term, and a Boltzmann term. So this is what you get this is universal. So now I want to optimize my cooling rate. So first I have to optimize with respect to this frequency that's connected to the cold bath. So in a way I have to kill this Boltzmann factor, otherwise this is going to go to zero. So immediately it says that the optimal frequency is proportional to TC. So when I get colder, the part that is coupled to my Hamiltonian is coupled to the cold bath, the frequency becomes lower and lower. So this has to happen. Otherwise, I can't cancel this. But you immediately see that if this goes to zero, also this will go to zero, and my cooling rate will vanish. But still I have this kinetic term here, which I have to figure out how does this depend on frequency. So the optimum is this, which is proportional to temperature. And now I have to know how the coupling to the bath scales with the frequency of my coupling. And we already know that this is a linear dependence, so I translated by doing that my problem to a temperature problem. So I know through this the relation between frequency and temperature, the frequency that's connected to the cold bath and the temperature. So this is a big reduction because we're going to a certain limit, so we can only now consider different models. So this is to summarize this. And we're looking all the time at optimal cooling rate. So when I get closer and closer to the absolute zero, I have to reduce my frequency. And this is always the optimum. So you can see my optimum approaches zero with the frequency. So now let's look at this term. We forgot about this coupling to the bath. In this case, it's model dependent. And we can look at different models to see how do I cool a refrigerator. So you can see one case, I want to cool an ideal Bose or Fermi gas, and I want to cool it. So in order to cool, as I said, I have to have some kind of interactions. This is a collision model that I have here that I'm going to use for coupling to the cold bath. So this is an expression, so it's basically a kind of a Poissonian type of particles that I have particles that collide with my, Bose gas or Fermi gas, taking energy out and repeating this process, so this is how I'm going to model my coupling. And now if you think about it, a little bit how this works, how do I cool a Bose gas? I can only cool the parts that are not condensed. So if I do Bose condensation, I take my gas, I condense it, so I have part of it is in this liquid, that let's call it the Bose condensation, but in equilibrium with that, I have the gas that's in equilibrium with the Bose gas. This is my handle. This I can let collide with other particles and reduce its energy. But when I get colder and colder, the part, non-condensed parts become smaller and smaller, and eventually I have nothing to work with. So it's a question of really scaling of, for example, Bose gas, the heat capacity scales as Tc to the power of 3/2. And if we talk about Fermi gas, the heat capacity scales linearly with temperature. And then if we look at this kinetic term here, that how does it scale? It scales with, or we could say, this exponent that we need for Nernst theorem, this alpha, we can show eventually that our exponent becomes, in both Fermi and Bose gas, 3/2. So we're safe from the point of view of the third law. We can't cool to absolute zero. Eventually, we can find an exponent that will tell us that this temperature will scale with temperature as 3/2, which is larger than 1, and so we're safe. So this is one, you can say, universal model, Bose of Fermi gas. The other model, which is more difficult in a way, is a bath, which is harmonic cold bath, or you could say a harmonic bath. So radiation, I would say, is the ideal bath like that. You can say that radiation is composed from frequencies. So here's our model for the bath. It has many frequencies, and now we're coupling to these frequencies in a linear way. And then the question is, how does this coupling scale with the temperature of the cold bath? So to make this in a way more simple, we can think about that if my bath is contained in this box, I couple to the surface and I have a volume. So when I couple to the surface, I generate an event, sometimes it's called Lieb-Robinson, but in this case, if it would be radiation, this event will go to the speed of light that will generate equilibration. So you can say this kinetic coefficient should be proportional to these terms here, and these the omega c here is these the dimension, and this kappa is a dispersion relation of my gas. So this again depends on dimensionality, which, and here this model is built like a spectral. This is would be the standard spectral density. This is how it goes. So if you look and analyze all these coefficients together, you see that in this case you can use the third law to say something about dispersion relations, that the cooling power should scale as a dimension plus kappa, which comes from this dispersion relation, and the heat capacity should scale with the dimension for this type of bath, and eventually this exponent becomes this dispersion relation, which means it has to be larger than 1. So you can take this argument and say that in order to the third law to be correct, the dispersion relation of your bath has to be larger than 1. So if you want to have a sub-ohmic bath, it violates the third law of thermodynamics. So does it mean it doesn't exist? It could exist in certain parameter range, but if you go to absolute zero, you can't have a bath like that. So radiation is perfect. K is equal to 1, and dispersion law, you can see, for radiation is linear. So if I have a bath composed of radiation, I'm safe with relation to the third law. There's a way to understand that, which is why you can't have a dispersion relation that's smaller than 1, at least for this type of bath. Since this bath is a linear bath, you can kind of diagonalize it with the coupling, and you can show, if I have a set of harmonic oscillators and I diagonalize them, if I want this to be legitimate, I need all my frequencies to be positive. If one of my frequencies becomes negative, there is no third law, because I don't have a ground state. So, to have a positive k larger than 1, you can say, is to rule out this possibility that they have negative frequencies. So this is work, this has been already observed by Donke, 20 or 25 years ago, but this is just shows you that you can write any type of dispersion relation for your subohmic, ohmic. People use all kinds of density of states and ideas, but if you are strict and you say, okay, the third law is something that has to be obeyed, there are restrictions that, here, this is k, in order to obey the third law, has to be larger than 2 minus the density. Okay, this is just an illustration of what I'm showing you. This is the current as a function of temperature. So you see the current vanishes when we approach the absolute zero. So here, this is phonons or photons, doesn't matter, it goes as minus this tc to the fourth. This goes, this is Bose gas, Fermi gas, this is how they cool when you approach to the absolute zero, at least according to this theory. And here is how the temperature decreases, and you can see this is, in this case, the temperature for the Bose gas, the phonons is linear, and in this case, both Fermi is this exponent t to the 3 halves. This is what we get. Okay, so to summarize this, you can say all refrigerators close to have this kind of form. They have a quantum energy, they have a coupling term, and they have a gain. And this is, we're looking at the scaling of these, let's say, for example, this coupling with temperature, so we can get a scaling like that. And we know that if we are close to cold temperatures, omega C has to be proportional to TC. And you can say this saves us. The second law and third law are, in a way, saved. And again, we can use this in opposite way. Okay, so before I go to the last thing I want to say, so are there questions here about the third law, or when is lunch, let's put it like that.
We have lots of time.
Okay, good. So I have another thing that. Okay, so before I go to talk about the quantum flywheel, so are there any questions about the third law, which is something that most people didn't, who studied the third law in a course? So the third law is an important part of thermodynamics, and the way I like to present it, that this is our safeguard. We can derive something, and then we can use that to check. So here, I showed you how we can use the third law to check dispersion relations. So this is, for example, an argument I have with Gershon Kowitzki, that he brought some obscure dispersion relations of magnons, and he says they violate the third law. It's true that they violate. But the question is, do magnums exist at close to zero temperature, which I think they do. So this is, it's an open argument, and I'm giving you the other side. And again, you can find in the literature many descriptions of quantum refrigerators that violate the third law. And there's people don't have to be careful about it, but if you do things wrong, you get it.
Again, with local mass radiation is preferable to for the third law cases.
What the global of? In a way, it doesn't. You can say at this level, it won't matter, because you can say everything boils out to this coupling. And this, so the question is, how does this coupling scale with frequency? So we know
So
you could say, when you reach absolute zero, kind of everything goes orbit. Everything is limited by this link. This we can have, it's irreversible. And if you think about laser cooling, the people who do laser cooling don't pay the electricity. They don't care about the efficiency of laser cooling. The university pays the electricity. So they have these high-powered lasers, and they run this transition very fast. What they care about is how cold is this. So in a way, their optimization is such that they try to optimize this link here. So then it becomes a bottleneck. So the bottleneck becomes this kinetic coefficient, which is not universal, it's not a little bit, that's why it's model dependent, depending on what you want to call. But you could say, if you think of, for example, about a finite Boltz gas, you'll cool first the Boltz gas, then let's say you don't have any condensate up, but then you have these Bogliubov excitations which have a dispersion relation like harmonic, okay? So like phonons. So if it's finite, you'll have excitations that you also, if you want to cool it, you'll have to cool down the waves inside your Boltz condensate.
These Bogliubov excitations are also sent, and some people think they're in the squeeze states, even at zero temperature, which can change the entropy.
Yeah, so so I think the third law would be a good kind of way to think about it. If you reached zero temperature, you should have no excitations. So if your theory shows that there are excitations, correct my way to think, correct your theory. Get rid of your, this is a, would be a good, correct your theory. Okay, so now we'll go back to an important problem, is how to store energy or store power. And in a way, we heard about it yesterday. So, we have our engine. Here's hot, cold. So what do we do with our power? We want to store it. So we need a storage device. Power is something that we want to use on demand. So you could say there are two types of storage devices that we can consider. One is a flywheel, which is I'm going to talk about first. And the other one is a battery. So what's the difference? It's long-term or short-term. A flywheel, every engine has a flywheel. Usually it's, again, one of these things under the hood you never look at. But you can see there, you have a flywheel in the engine. And the idea of a flywheel is a short-term storage of power. So if you have energy stored in this flywheel, so then when I need power, I can have it on demand. So you can say let's say my engine normally works at 20 horsepower and I want to pass this guy, I need 25, I can take it from the flywheel and then give it back. So this is fast. So for a flywheel, we can have things that are relatively short in time. And for a battery, we usually think we want to store it for a long time and then use it at later time. That's why batteries, chemical storage is preferable. That's usually what we have. But now we want quantum versions for both flywheels and in a way batteries, and we want to kind of understand how this works in the quantum limit. And so now we're going to explicitly, until now you can say this part here was implicit, but now this part is going to be more explicit. We'll have a device that absorbs our power. And we'll see there is a subtle change. Once we have this device that absorbs the power, we have to rethink about many things about our engine. So, way to treat it, let's do a model. So the model is, that I'm going to use, is a four-level four-level system. So I have the hot side, again with omega H, the cold side with omega C, and I'll have my power will be a swap. So if I take power from here, I'll go up here, and the rest will go out to the other one. So it's again the same tricycle. So I can say in this case if I want to write the Hamiltonian, I'll have here I'm going down, sigma minus hot. Here I'm going up, sigma plus cold. And I'm generating in my flywheel an excitation. Need another color. So what did we call it? B. So again, it's the same structure that we had before. It's a tricycle. You have these three nonlinear operations. You could say the difference between what I said before, that now my flywheel is finite. It's not an infinite bath that I can reduce. It's going to be a finite system that I can analyze. So this is will be the model that we want to consider here. And here you can see, you could write it like that. If it was the same type of interaction I said before here, I don't know why Amika, my student, chose the Y operator, so it's minus here, doesn't matter. Could be plus without this, with a coupling string. And what we're going to use, this will be a two-level system, this will be a two-level system, and my flywheel will be the harmonic oscillator. Why is a harmonic oscillator a flywheel? Because I can excite it and it can absorb as much energy as I want. So my pendulum can take the energy and then I can use it. So here's a reduced description. Here are these energy levels. So this is something that I can do. I can write this, these are two qubits. I can write them in a different way. I can write them as combined 1-1. Both are excited. The first one is excited, the second one not. 0-1 and 0-0. None of them excited. So if I couple this to this path, and this to this path, and I look at the populations that I have, you can see that the populations go like that. I have very little population at this level. Here I have quite a lot of population, here I have less, and most of the population is in the ground state. So if you look at this, I have population inversion between these two levels.